worship him.
You are Yahweh. Hey, you are Yahweh.
You are Yahweh.
You are Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Alpha, Omega.
To pray that this day register your presence in the presence of God today. Lord Jesus, that I want to meet me today in this service, Lord. Cause me to encounter your power today. Cause me to encounter your spirit today. Lord Jesus Christ, I want to fellowship with you, Lord Jesus Christ. Let me have an encounter with you today, Lord Jesus Christ. Encounter with you today. As I now return the same way, Lord, meet me at the point of my need in this service today.
Magnify your name. We exalt your holy name. You are all that we have, and you are more than enough for us. You have not left us here without a witness in our life. We commit this service unto you, Lord. Take absolute control in the mighty name of Jesus. Let your name be glorified in this service in the mighty name of Jesus. Let your word increase in this service in the mighty name of Jesus. Give us the understanding to the word in the mighty name of Jesus. Let your word feel impact in our life in the mighty name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Shall we be on our feet, please? The book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 1. For a background text to our class today. Revelation, chapter 1. Verse 1. Are we there? All right. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. Let's read together. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. May the Lord add blessings to the reading of his word. Let's be seated, please. We give God thanks and praise for our gathering today, for his grace and his mercies over our lives. And the understanding that the times are evil. Wickedness continues to soar high into highest levels. Darkness mounts up, but in his own mercies, he has the power of preservation. So he preserves us from day to day. He preserves us from service to service. And we return thanks unto him by whose power we are preserved. We also, as we gather like this morning, it's a resurrection morning. We call to mind some 2,000 years back on a Sunday like this, before the S-U-N sun rose, the S-U-N sun rose up to give life to those that were dead. We thank him because it is by that resurrection, because of that resurrection, we are able to gather like this and are seated with him together in heavenly places. So we thank God for that day. We thank God for today. We return all praise, glory, and honor to our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise God. And we welcome everyone to church this morning, and we ask that the blessings of the Lord will rest upon each and every one today in Jesus Christ's name. On Friday, an assignment pastor gave us from the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. He that is joined unto an harlot is one body. And so we began to attempt that on Friday, and we'll drive in that direction maybe in our next few classes, by God's grace. But the topic that we are handling now is the three women in the revelation of Jesus Christ. The three women in the revelation of Jesus Christ. Hopefully, this will help those that are new to have a better understanding of what we believe according to the scriptures, and what our testimony is. And also to help those who are also have been here too, to be better grounded in the truth, to be better grounded in the present truth, so we know how to order our steps. The three women in the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, one of the problems, I think our brother on Friday was saying, what waiting person not know, pass them. And that's true. But when somebody doesn't know that is more than him, but that thing is important, then the person begins to give diligence to know that thing. So it is not enough to identify that waiting person not know, pass them. But it is better to begin to put forth an effort to know that thing when past you. Because that these things are given to the sons of men. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1, where we read. It said, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants. So those things now cannot pass his servants. Because it was given to show it to his servants. His servants, they are those that serve him. It's not only pastors. All who serves Jesus, they are servants of Jesus Christ. Now, if we serve, if we say, I am serving the Lord Jesus Christ, now he has a revelation to show you. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. If you say, I am serving the Lord Jesus, he has a revelation that he wants to show you. Praise God. And now, here's where the churches today have lots of problems. One of the greatest problems with the church today is that the church rejects counsel. The church rejects the revelation that Jesus has to show. Praise God. And rejection of revelation is something that is very risky. Very, very risky to the soul of anybody. Now, it's... the new people, they have not come. Our members, they are not here. See, so these things, when these things are being taught like this, then after some, maybe 2 weeks, an assignment goes and says, what is this and stuff, then it looks like something that has not been taught here before. But it's because of all these things now. But the Lord will give us understanding. Now, the prophet was talking to, sending a message. The prophet got a revelation concerning one man, and he sent the message to him because he was going to minister. So he sent them and said, go and tell such and such a person that today he should go and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. If he is not baptized today by 7 p.m., those people that are carrying dead bodies will be at his door to carry his body. And the person took the revelation to the man and said, the same man I tell you, say, when you go baptize in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ today. Otherwise, by 7 p.m. today, people, when they carry dead body, the poor bearers, they will be at your doorstep to carry your body out. And the man said, yeah, we get, I beg, all this. But the man that they sent to tell him was an unbeliever. That man was a very strong man, not a year. They sent the in, but the prophet did something that made him go on that message. Because the prophet met him at the filling gas station where he was trying to buy gas. He had only $1 in his pocket. And he was trying to use that $1 to buy gas for his car. So when the prophet gave him the message, the prophet asked the attendant to fill his tank. And then he was telling the prophet, no, don't worry, I'll take care of it. And the prophet said, fill his tank. Keep that $1 you have. Leave it in your pocket. So when he told him how much was in his pocket, it now made him to understand that he needs to go for this message, even though he does not believe God. So when he went to tell somebody that says he's a Christian, somebody that is not a Christian now went to tell somebody that says he's a Christian, see what they say, I should tell you. They say, you go and baptize. They say, be this one. You believe God? You say, that will not cause. They say, may you go baptize in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Otherwise, by 7 p.m. today, they will come and carry your dead body from this house. And the man didn't go. The unbeliever was there. By 7 p.m., they came to carry that man's dead body out of the house. It is the problem with people. People downplay revelations. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, I think verse 20. If somebody can help us read, please. Thank you, sir. Despise not prophesying. See, that's prophecy. The word of prophecy, when it comes like this, don't despise it. Try to understand it. Try to prove it. Test every spirit. If you have tested that this prophecy is coming by the Spirit of God, you better work with it. Pastor was telling us some other time that he told one man, a revelation came to him, and he told the man that you will not cross into the next month, I think. You will not cross, you will not cross February into March. So you better put yourself in order and do, he was asked to do certain things. I said, you better do those things that the Spirit of the Lord has asked you to do, otherwise you will not cross February into March. And the man went home and swimming and all. And the man sat there. And because they said he will not cross into, so he decided to stay awake to see 12 o'clock. So he was watching film that day. I'll be better than news in the watch with his daughter. He was watching TV and hair. He watch him. Watch him reach 10. He's still there alive. Watch him reach 11. 11:30. He's still there alive. Then they doze off for there. My daughter said, go and sleep now. leave all these things. Still time is already 11:30. What are you waiting for? Try and best. Then, just as it was getting close to 12, he dozed off. Then from there, he went. Then they called pastor the next day to say, that thing that you said, because they went to try to wake him up. Because that thing that you said, see, oh, the man, come and pray for him to come back. Oh. And pastor said he was trying to put himself together to go, and the Spirit of the Lord told him, where are you going? See, it's a problem with the church. The church despises prophecy. Now, if the things that are spoken by men are steadfast, and the Lord will not allow them fall to the ground, how much more the things that are spoken by the Lord Jesus Christ? How much more the revelation that Jesus Christ has to give unto the church? Now, the great number of churches today downplay, especially this book of Revelation. It's like, no concern. It's like, go there. It's like, not be we get them, not be our own, just say. But the thing was sent and to show to his servants things that will soon happen. But the church despises it. But by his mercies, he has caused us to have an understanding of these things. Praise God. Now, in the revelation of Jesus Christ, there are three women. In this revelation of Jesus Christ that God gave him to show to us, there are three women. And now, we want to look at these three women over the course of the next teachings. Now, so that we will know who we are, so that we will know how to maintain our calling, we will know how to maintain where we are supposed to stand, then we will know who the others are, then we will know what we can relate with and what we cannot relate with. All these things are contained in this, inside the revelation of Jesus Christ to the church. We said one time that the scripture said, knowledge shall be increased in these times. And but in these times, you still find that the bulk of people who say they are Christians are still having their knowledge in the exact same spot it was some years back. What you knew when you came is that Jesus Christ loves you. That's what you still know. What you know is that fornication is bad. That's what you still know. For over how many years, that's what you know. That love your neighbor as yourself. For over how many years, that's what you know. I'm sorry, but that person is not walking in the revelation of the Spirit. Because the Spirit has said, knowledge shall increase. And the Spirit did not cap it to only the church. So when we see outside the church, look at the political scenes, look at the scientific scenes, there has been so much upgrade of knowledge. In just these past few decades, the knowledge that has gone up cannot be compared to other years. In just these past few decades, see, from before 2G finished, 3D don't enter, before 4G don't come out, 4.5, then 5G, the thing just they go, it just they go. And see, they are trying to announce another G. We never do 5G for this country. And Nigeria is very backward in knowledge. See, you see the problem? Nigeria is very backward in knowledge, very backward in scientific knowledge. Since we still struggle to enter 4G. Since and 4G never circulated. The thing when they show for your phone now, fake. That one, the guys that they arrange them. If 4G enter your phone, if you press something for your phone, you will not say they use 4G. But that's the problem. The country is backward in knowledge. Now, just as Nigeria is backward in knowledge, see all the problems it's causing now. And kidnapping on the road. Nothing. Okay, let fire break out here. Then wait for fire services. To come and fire. You go, don't burn, finish. Before maybe they go even come with empty tank. What happened? No water. What happened? No fuel. Is a backward, you see, knowledge ought to have increased. Then the countries increase with knowledge. See the countries, see China now. See China. China that was nowhere before. They just came, they overtook the whole thing because of knowledge. And now America and everything, they are going to China to produce. Everybody's going to China. China went just come up with the year. See South Africa. South Africa that was backward, behind Nigeria. See them now. See Dubai.
sand, desert, desert. In how many years? See the place now. Go to the place. Sometimes, some places you not even see human being. Human being now, machine, but they attend to people and stuff. All these countries, they try to keep up with the increase of knowledge, so they were not left behind. But people like Nigeria, they don't really keep up. Just they where they did. Analog must be manual. You go into office, big office, they will go and look for big file. You'll be looking for a file of 20 years, and the country cannot keep fine. Small time, fire will catch the building. Backward. Now, just as Nigeria is backward, it has gone backward in the world today, that's supposed to be the giants of Africa. The churches have gone backward, that's supposed to be the light of the world. Why? Knowledge increased the day where they did. Jesus loves us. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus died for you. 2,000 years, that's what we have been saying. The scripture said knowledge shall go up. So if your knowledge has not gone up, you are not going up, you will not go up in the rapture. Because people are expected to go up in the rapture. So for those who feel that, what do you need all these things for? What do you need all these mysteries for? What do you need all this knowledge for? Just live the simple life. Don't worry. Live the simple life. You will remain here in the simple life. Because the scripture said, unto you it is given to know. There's somebody to whom it is given to know. He's saying, what do we need this for? No, now you know more than God that gave you to know. Praise God. It's the problem with the churches today. I would have loved that our new people will be hearing these things so that they will have an understanding of where the kind of gathering that we have come to. You see, our gathering is not, we are not a denomination. We are not an organization, a church organized under the leadership of man. We are organized by the leadership of the Holy Ghost. Praise God. I would have loved our new brethren to be hearing this so they know how to stand, how to walk. Praise God. Now, the church is used to despising prophecies. But now we are bringing up these revelations these women in the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ and see how we relate with it. The first woman that I would like to look at is that woman, Jezebel. That's the first woman. Now, the second woman we'll be looking at is that woman, the bride. The third woman is that woman, Israel. Today, we are looking at that woman, Jezebel. We'll take it. I don't think we'll be able to finish this today. So we'll take the woman, Jezebel. Now, we'll see her runnings through the scriptures and everything. Then, whenever we finish that, we'll go into the next one. Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, verse 20 to 23. Now, notwithstanding, now this is the fourth church age, the Thyatirian church age. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee. Hey, see. This is, I believe Jesus. I love Jesus. I love Jesus. He's my friend. I will ever follow him. He's my friend. Everybody loves Jesus. It is Jesus that is talking here. And he's talking to the church. And he's saying, notwithstanding, I, the Lord Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, the captain of the salvation of the church, is saying, telling the church something. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against you. One of it is, thou sufferest that woman Jezebel. Now, if we don't know who that woman Jezebel is, supposing we're part of those that allows her to suffer, when he says thou sufferest, is that thou allowest. See, they don't rebuke her. They didn't rebuke her. They didn't try to hinder her. You see, the scripture said, I suffer not a woman to teach. So the scripture limits. The scripture hinders, stops. It tries to stop the woman from expressing in leadership in the church. But now, he said, thou sufferest not. They do not hinder her. They gave her free hand. They gave her We're entering into fellowship with the woman. It is the church that was doing this thing. So then, now, if somebody says I'm a Christian, but he does not even know who that woman Jezebel is, then you are giving the woman Jezebel free hand. You are allowing the woman Jezebel to operate freely. Then when you come to that great throne of judgment, then the Lord Jesus stands there, and you are expecting that he will give you a pass. Then he said, but no. You suffered that woman Jezebel to express. What will be the lot? This is where the power of revelation is. My people perish for lack of knowledge. Not the heathens, his people. So clearly put, Christians perish for lack of knowledge. They will just not sit down to read. They will just not sit down to study. Now when somebody that has sat down to study is talking by the grace of the Spirit, they will not just put ear there. Then what will happen? That person will perish now. How will man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Then every word is proceeding. Pastor is teaching. Every word is proceeding. Then somebody is sleeping. Does that man want to live? Praise God. Please, sir, continue. Which called herself a prophetess to teach and to seduce my servants. Now, these are the servants. These are the servants of Jesus. So, who this woman? Now, the woman has a testimony about herself. It's not God that called her a prophetess. She calls herself a prophet as a teacher. She calls herself a teacher. Now, if she has given herself that office, that ministry to teach, then now see who she's teaching. She is teaching the servants of God. Praise God. She's teaching God's servants. Now, we said earlier when we started, the servants of God are not just the preachers. The preachers are servants of God in the capacity that they are serving God. Now, those also who are doing whatsoever it is, we have all been called into the service of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, plus the teachers, plus the sweepers, plus the singers, plus the prophesiers, plus the miracle workers, whatsoever it is, because a Christian can never be jobless. There's a service. He said there's a supply that we're making. Every joint must supply. The scripture told us. So if somebody's in church and is not supplying, forget, you are wasting your time in church. You are not a Christian. Because there's something you are supposed to be supplying. But now you are hindering the church. You are hindering the body from that thing you are supposed to supply. For whatever reason, whether it's shame, whether it's pride, whatsoever reason you are hindering the church, you are not a Christian. You are not a Christian. Every joint must supply. Praise God. Now, when you are supplying, it is a service. And for those who receive pay for their supply, yeah, money. They have to pay you to supply. No, you are not a Christian. You are something else. You are a mechanic. You are a generator repairer. You are not a Christian. You're not a Christian. Now I see music festival, worship festivals, and then the great gospel singers that we have in the country. They hire them. They go and they pay them to come. Then you come and that day and come and say, "Hiya, Salam." We say, "Quiet, why are you waiting? After we don't pay you, why will you not speak tongues? Their gods are their bellies. Why will you not come? Hiya, Salam. Come and sing." So we'll pay you to come and worship God. You say, you meet, talk to my manager. Your manager will say, he doesn't have time. They have paid him to come. And how much? No, he cannot come under 1 million. He cannot come under 3 million. To worship God. Because God gave you a gift, to use the gift to magnify him, they will pay you. No, this is not a Christian. Speak tongues from beginning to the end of that service. You are not a Christian. They have Frank Edwards and all these people, managers. It's a worship feast, festival. The church, we hire What's the difference between you and what's that man? Davido. Before Davido comes to your birthday show, before Davido comes to your party, before Davido comes to your club, you go pay money. And then the man will come there, call the Miami song. You go do and do and do and go, you see how they sweat. He's working for his money. He's working for his money. Then you too, you won't say it's God that brought you into the service. Then they will now give you money too. Then you come here and be shouting in tongues and be saying, fall, just lost under my voice. Under my voice, let there be healing. Under my voice, let there, hey, you are not a Christian. You are working for your money. Praise God. Some people come to church and say, what can the church pay me? What can the church, if I want to come and play organ, if I want to come and play bass, what can the church pay me? They cannot afford me. You are not a Christian. You are just, just enter hip-hop and go and play. And make good money with your skills. And you know, sometimes when they come, and if we need them, we will call, and we will, if we have money, we will pay. We say, hey, come, stay. We'll be giving you 5,000. We'll be giving you something. Because we are waiting for God to raise children. You take notes. In a house like that, when a man has not yet given birth to children, but so many tax, and he will hire herself. That, you know they pay them? You go pay them first. You go to pay them. But watch, once that man has children, and children have grown to be able to handle responsibilities, the same thing that those helps were doing, the child will be doing the same thing, but the father does not pay him. Praise God. These are hired helps. You just take the play drum first. One day, God will raise drummer. Inside the house. This one will not be servant. This one is a child of God. He go play the thing. He say, come and take it. Say, wait. For my own service, this is my own supply to the body. Praise God. They pay you to come and pray. I saw a signboard the other day, say prayer warriors wanted, salary 20, very attractive. I said that prayer warriors wanted, salary very attractive. Then when they will go and do the interview, then they hire the person. Maybe in the interview they will say, speak in tongues, let me hear. Then the person will say, Bosakalabanata. They say, hey, this one has strong prayer warrior. Then when they hire the person out there, you come and be sweating and say, ha, ta, ta, ta. Nothing. No, that money, you are working for your money and not working for God. But here, Jesus was talking to his servants. He said, thou sufferest that woman Jezebel to teach my servants. It was the sea where the servants of God began to collect. They were collecting from the hand of a woman that called herself a prophetess. That's where they were collecting from. Kai, I see men today, they collect from the hand of women. Mommy G.O. My mommy, this is my mommy. You are failed. You are failed. You see that a woman is the pastor. You say, hi, my mommy said, as our mommy said, you are a failure. You are finished. You collect. This is where you are collecting from. He said, thou sufferest that woman Jezebel to teach my servants. The first thing is that she was not even qualified to teach. She was not qualified because I suffer not a woman to teach. So she was not even qualified by God. But the church allowed her. Why? And what a man can do, a woman can do better. All these ideologies that came up and popped up from the world, the church imbibed it and began to operate with it. In the name of civilization. Sorry, sir, I'm keeping you standing. In the book of Acts, Judas had fallen. Now they were 11. But the apostleship needed to be 12 to be complete. Then they said, let us appoint someone into this ministry of the apostleship with us. He said, but we will choose somebody. It has to be somebody that has been with us from the beginning, even from the ministry of John. People appoint people into a ministry. It's somebody that knows nothing about the beginning. You see where the problem is? People appoint people into ministry, appoint somebody a pastor. The person knows nothing about the beginning. When our Lord came, he was telling them something. I said, from the beginning, it was not so. If you don't know what was in the beginning, how will you know what to expect now? How will you know what to do now? We need men that knows the setting of things in the beginning. See Elijah. They came. He came up to pray. He came up to pray and consume that thing with fire. But he knew what was in the beginning. Then when he came up, the altar was not standing like it was standing in the beginning. Then he needed to set the stones. He said he built again the altar of the Lord. Then he put stone upon stone. 12 stones according to the 12 tribes. Each one on each other. Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah. He put everyone on top of each other. Then when he had set it, then he could pray. Men that know nothing about the beginning are pastors. Then they become emotional speakers. Motivational speakers. If you have tried today, keep trying. Keep trying. Keep trying. That's it. Don't stop trying. Don't stop trying. Don't stop trying. Mark Zuckerberg didn't stop trying. And Jack Ma, the Alibaba owner, he didn't stop trying. He was rejected in 27 interviews. How many interviews have you gone to? Is this teaching? This sermon? Hey, nothing, no knowledge about the beginning. See, but those men said, check, we will bring men that were with us from the beginning, even from John the Baptist ministry. He said, then we will bring, he said, select two from there. Then we will cast lots and pray. Then let God appoint one into the office. Now, I used to ask people, if they were going to operate under the spirit of fairness, why did they not bring one man and one woman? Because in that gathering that day, we had very big women, in quotes, if we put it today. Mary, the one that gave birth to Jesus, she was there. Who would have been, who would have been better qualified in our own arrangement? Who would have been a better qualified person to enter into the ministry than somebody that knows at the table now? I didn't take crawl. I didn't start to work. I didn't start to do everything. She was there when the first miracle was done. Now she advised the man, say, anything he talk, men are do amu. She was there. Yeah, who would have been better qualified? But that, they were not working according to the ideas of men. They took two women, took two men, and ordained and prayed, cast lot. Then three, they picked one. Praise God. Now, but see, he said he was teaching the servants of God. Please continue, sir. To commit fornication. And to eat things sacrificed unto idols. Okay. Please, just read. Yes, sir. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication. And she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed and them that commit adultery with her. See why it's important to know what this woman is and who this woman is. Because there's a judgment that is hanging not only on the woman, but people that are associated with the woman. Okay. Please continue reading. Okay. Okay. Yes. Titeria, yes. Thank you, sir. The message to the Titerian church. Now, Christ was telling that church age that I will not put another burden on you. Your only burden, the only thing that you have to do is to challenge this woman. The only thing that you have to do is just be challenging this woman. Now, if you like, create another thing that you want to do for yourself. Now, you give yourself that work. The work when I send those people when they're that age, challenges, just resist this woman. He said, I will put none other burden on you. Your own is to, when you say, I believe Jesus, good. The burden that you have for that age, for that fourth church age, the burden that was on the shoulder of Christians was resist that woman. I was not going to put any other burden. I will not, not anything that they say Christian. In short, I don't know, in that Titerian age, if anything they were doing was not geared towards resisting the woman, it was your own righteousness. You are just doing something for your own self. And that thing that you are doing cannot qualify you to be saved. It cannot. Why? Because he said, I will put none other burden. So the burden that he needed them to fulfill in that age was resist this woman. Praise God. And he was saying, as many as have not this doctrine, which have not known the depths of Satan. So then there's the doctrine that he's talking about, which comes out from the depths of Satan. Okay. Now, who is this woman? I said the first woman we are picking up is that woman, Jezebel. Now, we are seeing her here in the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. Question is, who is this woman? What does she represent? Now, this is a revelation, don't forget. Now, when the prophets come here sometimes and they see certain things, then you hear them begin to say, then I was asking the Lord, what's the meaning? Prophet Jeremiah, he said he saw a lady was standing and tortoise on Friday, in prayers on Friday, and the tortoise was just around coming in front of the lady like this. He said then he was asking, what is this thing? And he said, it's spirit of slowness and delay and all that stuff. Now, it's because it's a revelation. It's usually delivered in symbols. They deliver it in signs. Then the person that it is delivered to begins to inquire. He begins to inquire, what is this thing for? Okay, why is it there? Okay, what is it doing there? Okay, what should now happen? He begins to make inquiries. Now, this is a revelation too. And in that revelation, a woman came up and he called the woman Jezebel. And the Lord was warning the church about the woman and everything. Now, the next thing is that the church, therefore, now begins to inquire, who is this woman? What's she about? What's she doing here? Okay, what do we do? But now, that is where the church despises prophecies, like we started. So people despise these things and say, I'm a Christian. Nothing. Praise God. Now, it says, notwithstanding that sufferance, that woman, Jezebel, which calls herself a prophetess to teach. Now, to understand this woman, as it's being set here, because we know, every Bible, maybe every person that has been exposed to the Bible knows that there was a Jezebel in the scriptures, the mother of makeup. The mother of makeup. Touch him. Put blush. Aya, put shadow. Now that woman, no. Nashi. That's who brought it into Israel. So, as many as love to be daughters of the woman, continuing that, we don't come out our own hand because we know where it came from. Painting has never been an expression of Christianity. It has never been an expression of God's people. Right from the beginning, it has been an expression of hedonism. So when you go to Babalawo house, you ever see Babalawo face clean? He must draw something. If you never draw something, it's not a Babalawo. Don't see somebody when not draw anything, come the shake staff for you, go fear them. When you don't put circle for eye with white, qua, they put two. Yeah. Now when it come, they shake that thing, qua, qua, you go not say, hey, it don't come, oh, naim. There must be something on the, he must put something. It has always been an expression of hedonism. But when you go to the temple of God and see those priests, go and look at how they are set in Leviticus. Clean. He said, let them not make any markings on their body for the dead. Not paintings. Don't draw any tattoo. He said, place no tattoo. Don't draw nothing. Just ordain them. Let oil be poured on their head. So when you see those ones, you see oil on their head. Praise God. May oil not depart from our head in Jesus Christ's name. He said, thou anointest my head with oil. This thing is too loud, please. If thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runs over. Praise God. Now, who is this woman? We'll look at her standing before, because this woman is somebody that has run before. Now, when the physical Israel was walking with God, when the physical Israel was operating with God, this woman came up at some point inside their journeys. About the thousands of years that the physical Israel walked with God, this woman at some point raised up inside their journey. And when she raised up, she began to do certain things. Then then. Now, if you want to know about the woman, you can read 1 Kings from verse 16, from chapter 16. Just read. In verse 31, that's where she was married. And Ahab, the king of Israel, married her. This woman was not a daughter of Abraham. This woman was not a child of God. She was a daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Zidonians, that walked carelessly. And a daughter of a murderer, because her father was a murderer. She murdered the first man when they entered the throne. A daughter of a murderer. And from Zidon, the people of Zidon, who worship abominations for God. So the scriptures call it the abomination of the Zidonians. They worship Baal. They worship Astral and all these things. That's what these people worship in their land. Now, it is from there that this woman came. Now, when this woman came into Israel, she did come into Israel the proper channel, by the channels that God appointed for strangers to come into Israel. If you read in the scriptures, you'll notice that sometimes it speaks about the strangers that are among you and all that stuff. She didn't come into Israel through the proper channel. There was a woman called Ruth.
Correct. Ruth.
She was not an Israelite. She was a Moabite. She was from Moab. But she was brought into Israel. And she came in through proper channel. And she became one of the ancestors of our Lord Jesus. There was somebody called... what's that woman's name? Rahab. And she became... She was a prostitute. She was not an Israelite. She was in that Jericho people. But when she came into Israel, she became an Israelite and became one of the ancestors of our Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, a prostitute. Yes. Praise God. Became one of the ancestors of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, these women, they came in through the proper channel that the Lord had laid down. But Jezebel did not follow the proper channel. She just came in and then through political maneuvers, king, marry king, so that we will do strengthen the kingdom and all these things. Two political maneuvers. This one, king, talk to him friend when be king too. I could marry my daughter now so that we will seal the deal. You see, if now, say, okay, no, while I bring her. Marry. Then that's how she came into Israel to become a ruler. She came into the rulership in Israel. Now, if she had come in now and accepted the God of Israel, that would have been okay. But she came in with no thoughts of accepting the God of Israel. She came in and carried her gods with her. Then carried her traditions, carried everything, carried all those things and brought them into Israel. Now, no, she didn't come with her prophet. She met the prophets of God. She came in. Then she began to operate in the rulership of Israel. When she was operating in the rulership of Israel, she began to bring abominations into Israel. Now, it was something that was happening so that Israel would be overthrown from the worship of God. So that the knowledge of God will die out of the land. So that the abominations of her gods will be established in the land. Then, when she came in, see what she began to do. That was when the worship of Baal was established in Israel. Then, because they have established another god, they needed to raise prophets to that god. Then, she gathered the prophets of God. And the scripture, now we find this in 1 Kings 18, 19. It said, those that ate from her table, they were eating from the table of Jezebel. Yeah. they were eating from the table of this woman. Now, who are these? These are people that were supposed to be eating the bread of God. If you read in the Old Testament, the priests and those, they were supposed to be partakers of the bread. They were supposed to be partakers of the shoe bread. They were supposed to be partakers of the sacrifices. He said it is their portion. The prophets are supposed to partake of the sacrifices because they offer sacrifice like Elijah did. They offered sacrifices. They were supposed to eat from things that have been sacrificed to God. But these same people were now eating from Jezebel's table.
brought them in. And they were eating things that were sacrificed to idols, to Baal, to Ashtoreth. That's what she put on her table, and then they were eating. Now, when they began to eat those things, they began to commit fornication. Praise God. Then, after she has brought in those prophets, changed their eating table, changed their eating menu. Instead of eating unleavened bread, Kai, see better bread. When if you press like this, go in, you come outside. They eat that strong bread. Come here and eat something. Then brought out a cup, better wine, 9 days inside. They feed them. Okay. Now when she had changed their menu and eating table, and they were not eating large, they were still prophets. So the gift was still on them. They were still operating the gift. When she has changed it, now the ones that refused to change menu, the ones that refused to change eating table, she began to kill them. We are talking about the things that this Jezebel did when she expressed the first time. She began to kill them. She began to cut them off. Physically, she cut, killing them. And she killed all of them. Now, the ones that didn't want to die, they needed to go into hiding. She killed and killed and killed until she even threatened Elijah. So he said, when Elijah came and messed her place up, messed up her prophet, killed her prophet and everything, then they told her, see what Elijah did. And then she said, Kai, if your head still remains on top of your neck, see, may the gods do me waiting the one do me. If your head still remain and I not cut them, then Elijah took off and went to go and hide too. Then the scripture said, when he went to hide in that mountain, that when the spirit of the Lord came and met him, he said, what are you doing here? I said, you come, because what did they do here? He said, Lord. He said, they have, he said, you know how I've been zealous for your things. He said, they have finished all your prophets. He said, I alone, I am left, only me, and I remain for land, when they serve you. And now they want to kill me, now I run, come here. Then I go tell her, the Lord kill you, go anoint Elisha. If you take over from me, I'm going to take you home, don't worry, you have done your part. Anoint Elisha, anoint Jehu. The one that escaped the hand of Jehu, Elisha will kill. The one that escaped the hand of Elisha, Jehu will kill. You see, anoint those two, then me, I will carry you up. Don't worry. You see, God will carry the people that believe the Elijah message up. Yes, he will not leave us here for that man to kill us. Praise God. It's part of how we know that the church will not go through tribulation. The church will be taken up. Yes, because we will go into hiding now. God can say, we do not talk here. Praise God. Now, these were her works. She began to kill. Then, anybody that rejected her, she cut the person off. For like, Naboth. The man, Ahab offered the man money. Say, let me buy your land. I like him. He didn't get plenty. But the only one that Naboth had, he said, the inheritance. He said, let me buy it now. This land, they produce one kind. The thing is very attractive. And the man said, this is the only inheritance that I have. I cannot sell it for any reason. And the man was poor. He said, I cannot sell it for any reason. Kai, the thing, pain Ahab, pain and go out. And Jezebel, why in your face they do like this? He said, see one land I wanted to buy. The man refused to sell it. He said, that's all. Okay, go and eat bread. Go and eat bread. Just give me small time. If this land not come into your hand, I'll not be Jezebel. Then she rose up and write a letter, put the king's seal on it. In that letter, he told them what to do. He said, call up the Naboth. Put him, declare a fast. And say that this man has blasphemed God, the God of Israel. And the king. Now she was killing in the name of God of Israel. She was not killing in the name of Baal, of her own God. In the name of the God of Israel, this woman was going to kill those that refused to part with their possessions. Praise God. Then, of course, they ran the man out and killed him. Now, for all these things, judgment came upon her. Because he said to Ahab, he said, the place where dogs licked the blood of Naboth, dogs will lick your blood. And then that woman, Jezebel, he said, at the words of Jezreel, she will die and dogs will eat her flesh. Okay. Now, but this is that woman, Jezebel. You can find from verse chapter 16 of 1 Kings. Just read our record there. Now, we said this woman rose up at a point in Israel. As Israel was, physical Israel was walking with God. That's when this woman came up. Now, the woman now is being brought up again for a figure in the New Testament. Now, that was the Old Testament we just read. Now, this woman is being brought up again as a figure in the New Testament. She is appearing again. Now, what was the Spirit of God saying? Don't forget that that woman that was doing those things, she was only in a vessel. It was a spirit that was working in her. That spirit was working in her, like we said, to overthrow Israel. To bring Israel down. To make sure that the knowledge of God perish out of the land. And the ways of God were consumed out of the land. All those things. That's what that spirit was working to achieve in Israel. Now, when the gospel came over to spiritual Israel, we who are spiritual Israel, what our Lord was telling us in this revelation is that at some point in the walk of the spiritual Israelites with God, that same spirit will begin to manifest again. That same spirit will raise his head. Now, when that spirit raises his head, how will you know? It will be doing the exact same things that the spirit did before, because spirits don't change. Spirits don't change. Death does not even change a spirit. That's the Roman Catholics that pray for dead to move from purgatory and go to heaven. You see, death does not change the spirit. Death just changes the location. The spirit remains the same. Go and check. When Samuel died, he was a prophet when he was here. When he died, after some time, they invoked his spirit. The witch of Endor, better witch. Invoke spirit come up. And Samuel came up. When Samuel came up, and that king then asked him, he said, I beg. He said, when Samuel came up, the woman screamed. And he said, wait a minute. He said, I see gods rising up out of the earth. He said, describe for me the fashion of the god. He saw that Saul. He said, describe the thing that you saw for me. He said, it's an old man with a staff in his hand and a giddo around his waist. And Samuel said, Saul said, it is Samuel. And fell. And Samuel said, why have you disturbed me from my rest? He said, no verse. God not really talk to me by law, by the human dream, by dreams, by any prophet, by any, God has left me, forsake me. So I needed to call you. And Samuel began to tell him, he said, today, he said, your children, today, and you, all of now will die today. He began to prophesy. What's happening? The spirit did not change. He died a prophet. They invoked him. He was still prophesying. Praise God. See our Lord Jesus Christ. He died. He died the Redeemer. He died the Savior. When he rose up, he was still the same thing. Spirit did not change. God does not change. The spirit doesn't change. So when that spirit raises up inside the work of the New Testament Israel, the spiritual Israel, as the spiritual Israel is working with God, that spirit raises up. It will not change. It will come and do the same thing that it did before. It will still do the same things again. Praise God. I am able to finish this one today. Now, it says here, so when he referred to her as that woman, then what we know is that the spirit will be operating through a woman. The spirit will be operating through a woman. Now, this is in, like we said, this is in a revelation. When woman is used as a symbol, it represents a church. It represents a church. Ephesians, Paul said, I've espoused you unto one husband as a chaste virgin. See, Matthew 25, 10 women. A woman represents a church, symbolizes a church. Now, when he referred to her as a woman, it is that that same spirit that operated in Jezebel will rise up again and be operating in the church and doing the same things. What was the complaint of the spirit? He said, she was teaching my servants to eat things sacrificed unto idols. Kai, I don't have enough time. See, the servants of God were supposed to be eating something that has been sacrificed to the God of heaven. Jesus Christ said, I am that bread that came down from heaven. He said, except a man eats my flesh and drink my blood. See where the servants of God are supposed to be eating. The table prepared by God. He dropped a bread from heaven. That bread was Jesus. So when he said, eat my flesh, what he was saying is, eat my word, accept my word, receive my word. Because John 1 says, and the word was made flesh. So the flesh is his word. It's the word of God. They put it on the table and was saying, eat it. Now that was what Christians, servants of God, people that serve God, were supposed to be eating from the table of God. But when that woman rose up, what was she doing? She was teaching them to eat things that have been sacrificed to other gods. She was teaching them to eat bread, not that bread that came down from heaven. She was teaching them to eat bread that was tied to other altars. Praise God. This is what that woman was doing. Now he's saying this in the fourth church age. In that fourth church age, the only church that successfully did all these things was the Roman Catholic Church. The Roman Catholic Church. In that fourth, now we saw the gospel came to Rome. The gospel came to Rome. When the gospel came to Rome as seed, a few received it and mixed it with faith. They mixed it with faith. It produced the Church of God in Rome. This Romans from chapter 1 now, you see this. Romans from chapter 1. They mixed it with faith. It produced the Church of God there. But some others, when they received it, they did not mix it with faith. They mixed it with traditions. Now, that thing also produced a church. Now, there were two people. There were two women. There were two groups in Rome. Now, when it began to grow, it came in the course of time that by the third church age, the Pergamene church age, what happened is that woman, that one that mixed it with tradition, now see, she didn't come into Christianity by the proper channel, because the proper channel is repent and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for remission of sins. Leave those old traditions that you had before. Romans had their own traditions that they received from Babylon. They inherited from Babylon. They had their traditions and all those things. Now, they didn't leave those things. They packed it and mixed it together. They came to the third church age. In the third church age, they were married into rulership. In the third church age, the Roman Catholic Church came into rulership through marriage by Constantine. That man raised up the governor, the emperor, and said, I married the church and the state. He said the church and the state shouldn't be separate. For political reasons, he married the church and the state, merged them together, and organized the church. When that woman therefore came into power in the third church age, then she began to do the same works that spirit was doing in the Old Testament. When she came into power, the first thing is that she called herself a prophetess. She said, I am the first church. That's why she called herself a prophetess. It is me. It is us that have the oracles. Now we get the original. I am the first church. Now we go teach you now. What you now supposed to learn? I am the first church. She called herself a prophetess. Then she began to teach the servants of God to eat things that were sacrificed, that were tied to other, to their tradition, to their Roman tradition. What was she teaching? He began to teach pagan feasts, Christmas, Easter, what do you call the other thing? Valentine. She introduced all these things. Now, these things, they were Roman feasts, Roman traditions, things that were tied to their Roman gods, the God of love, and then what is the other one? It's, Tammuz, and then Nimrod, and all this. Now, Nimrod was born on the 25th. Of December. He was a god in Babylon, inherited by Rome. He was born on the 25th of December and was called the son of God in their mythology, called the Son of God, that is, and was tied to the father. He had a father, and Semiramis was the mother. So they had a mother and son worship. They were worshiping a mother and son, Semiramis and her baby. They were worshiping it. This one, Christianity never reached there. They were doing all these things before. Then they were having what you call Father Christmas, Lord of Misrule, a servant we assume and dress in red and white and all those clothes, colors, red, white, and begin to share gifts. Take the master's position in the house and begin to share gifts. They were doing it. Christianity never reached. They were doing all these things. They were celebrating all these things. Yes. They had a sterile priesthood. A sterile priesthood. Priests that don't marry. They had so many things running under their traditions. Then they had a pantheon of gods. That is, they had multiple god system. They believed that only one god could not hold the whole thing. So they shared it. This one is responsible for fertility. This one is responsible for agriculture. This one is responsible for the sun. This one is responsible for the river. This one is responsible for the rain. They shared it. Pantheon of gods. All these things were there. Now, when Christianity came in, they mixed them. So they said, okay, oh, there's a sun. That means, we don't need to clean our own now. We'll just merge it. So instead of say we are celebrating Nimrod, we'll say it's Jesus we are celebrating on the 25th. But take note that Jesus was not born in December. If you want to do the calculation, go and do your calculation. Either April or September or thereabout. Yes, either April or September. Christ, I mean, personally, I believe it was April. Because Christ, the scripture said, came in at the time of life. Christ came in at the time where lambs were born. Christ came in because he was the Lamb of God. When Christ came in, shepherds were in the field watching their flocks. Remember? Angels appeared to shepherds. They said they were at the field. In Israel, shepherds don't go to the field in December. It is snowing in the field. Shepherds don't take sheep out. Praise God. So you can see the time when John the Baptist, the angel came to minister to John the Baptist. When the angel ministered to John the Baptist, six months, he went to minister to Mary. So you calculate from the time the angel came to minister to John, 6 months. When he ministered to Mary, you know when Christ was born. It was not in December. No, but our Lord was not born in December. But even at that, he hid the thing. He hid the birth date. Because the God we are talking about is the God of eternity. You cannot tie him to a particular date. You cannot tie him to one time. So he did that. No beginning of days, nor end of life. That he was hid inside God. So then we celebrate Christ every day. We celebrate Christ every day. They don't tie one day and say it is time to do Christmas. Christmas is service of Christ. What have you been doing since? What are we doing now? We live that Christ. We live that life every day. Every waking moment, that is what we are here for. It's not one day we tie it, then we come and say, today is, we want to go and share it. We are sharing it every day. We are sharing it every day, every day. It's not one day. But they tie these things. Time now has said. They tie these things to, they began to teach the servants of God. They began to teach them Christmas, how to do Christmas on 25th, how to do Easter, God of fertility. They began to teach how to celebrate Easter, how to celebrate Easter. It was a pagan feast. Book of Acts said that. It was a pagan feast. They began to teach them how to celebrate Valentine, another love that was not the love of Christ, a love that was not tied to Christ. Where the scripture said, greater love had no man than this. Then another man came up with a love called Valentine. Now they began to celebrate that one. You know, February 14th and everything. Then they broke God up. They said God cannot be one. Then they break him. Pam, pam, pam. They say three. Yeah, at least three. At least. Let's just leave it as three. Three in one. Break them up to fit their traditions. Then they now needed to supply a mother. So they threw a mother into the picture and used our sister Mary. Threw a mentor inside the picture. They said, now you be mother. Now you come play Semiramis. Then they now needed to baptize into three gods. Because if you have broken God up into three, you must represent the three of them now. So then they now needed to baptize.
Then they changed the doctrine of baptism from the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to Titus unto three gods. They were just doing. What were they doing? They were teaching the servants of God to eat things. Now, this was a different bread than the one that came down. Now, they were eating a bread that was tied to Rome, that was tied to Babylon. When they began to do that, they were committing fornication with another god. So he said, taught my servants to eat things committed, sacrificed unto idols, when there's the body that was sacrificed unto God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, when they have taught these things, then those that were rejecting her teachings in that fourth church age, third and fourth church age, those that were rejecting her teachings, she began to kill. She killed wonderfully until in her record, she has killed over 68 million Christians. 68 million Christians, over. Yes, in her record, he began to kill. Anyone that will not accept her teachings, anyone that will not go or conform to her teachings, if you refuse to kiss the rosary, if you refuse to accept Mary, if you refuse to accept a dead saint to pray for you, you go down. And then went so much until she took the Bible from the hands of the people. It was a complete darkness. He took the Bible out of the people's hands. If they catch you with Bible that time, say you if they catch you with Bible, you die. No explanation. If they catch you with Bible, you die. This woman was doing all these things. Then, like Naboth, those that had something that was an inheritance to them, that they had inherited from their fathers, the faith that was once delivered unto the saints, that parchment of land that was growing precious fruit for us, we not greet Salam. Then he began to kill those people too. Anyone that refused to leave the former things that were taught by the fathers, he began to kill them. The same thing that spirit was doing. When the spirit was doing all these things, the Lord picked her up in his revelation and said, that woman, Jezebel, thou sufferest her, thou allowest her. They allowed them, because the church came into union, agreement with that, and they allowed her to call herself a prophetess, then to be teaching things sacrificed to and cause them to eat things that they had given to idols and all those stuff. They were eating it and commit fornications. Then, next Sunday, we'll be looking at from verse 21. I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. From then till now, she has had enough time to repent. She not going to change. She has wonderfully practiced and prospered and increased in her practices. See, then now, when God was going to judge her, he was not going to judge only in that Roman Catholic Church. He was going to judge the Roman Catholic Church and those that eat at her table. That's why I said it's important to identify this woman. So if you are eating one of the things that she distributed, vomitam, those that eat, those that partake of that table, he said, we will look at it in the next class. He said, I will kill her children with death. So in the next class, we'll focus on her children. Because the woman now, she's a woman and she gave birth. So she has children. So we are not only dodging the woman, we are dodging her children too. We'll tie it off to Revelation 17 next Sunday in Jesus Christ's name. I'll cut it off here today. Praise God. If you have any question, please, let's hear. And just to announce, the Sunday sermons, the Sunday school teachings too, they are usually available. You can talk to the recording department. For those that are, Brother Ephraim has been asking us to put this in announcement since we keep forgetting, so that if you missed it and you need it, you can get it from the recording department. Please try to put